everyone. I certainly like to thank everyone for coming out. I'm looking forward to an educational experience here. And so we have some ground. We're hoping that these are just academic, but we're going to beat them off to you anyway. We're hoping that people are listening responsibly without interrupting. I mean, that goes without saying, but that's what we're looking for. We ask that you understand others' views. You may differ in opinions, but we ask that you understand the views of people in this room that who may not think the same as you. You can criticize happiness, but please do not get into criticizing the people, okay? That just so we can avoid any kind of confrontation. This is a learning experience. This is not a debate. So we're going to have more questions. We're going to ask that we're going to open the floor up for questioning. People will be able to come up and ask questions, but they will not be able to ask a follow-up. We are not looking to get into a debate here with the panel on the stage. Avoid blaming, speculation, and inflammatory languages. That goes without saying. We're asking you to just be civil. Okay, thank you. So, in summing this up, I was asked many a time, why am I doing this? And quite frankly, that's simple. Enough is enough. We have had enough of gun violence. And when I watch, pour out their hearts on TV. You couldn't do anything but sit there and have your eyes melt up a tear. And as someone who's a gun owner, and an advocate sportsman, and a parent, I just couldn't sit on the sidelines and allow these kids to organize and to fight for their rights and actually fight for their lives without doing anything. What are adults in the room? We are supposed to be doing that. We're supposed to be protecting our youth. And so we should be coming up with the ideas and how to protect our kids, not them. So with that being said, I approached Maria and approached the question about doing this panel, and she told me to read, and so we have you guys here. And why Columbia County? Well, Columbia County, if many don't know, is now the home of the new NRA president. And that doesn't surprise me at all. In Columbia County, we have a vibrant sportsman community. I am part of that community. We like the hunt. We like the fish. I think we have gun owners in this community that are very conscious about gun safety. They love their community, and they certainly want to make sure their children are protected. And I believe that if we can get our sportsmen saying the same message as those kids who have been protesting across the country to protect themselves, that we can convince our legislators in Washington that something needs to be done. I know we have a lot of sportsmen in Columbia County who think the same way that I do. I talk to them on a daily basis, and I firmly believe that it is on our shoulders as parents, as sportsmen, as citizens to protect our youth. And we should be moving forward and doing that. So a call to action, we have a petition out in the hallway, and that petition, if you agree with the language that is on there, and I try to make it as ambiguous as possible, please do sign that petition, and so we can send that off to our federal elected officials to show them that if we can do it here in Columbia County, you can do it there where you live. And let's get some sensible laws passed to protect our kids. Thank you. So, I'd like to introduce our moderator for today. I am proud to say he's a professor of psychology and evolutionary studies at SUNY New Paltz, a founder member of Move Forward New York. He writes for Psychology Today, including many articles related to gun violence. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Let me introduce you, Quinn Garrett.
Thank you so much, really, for all your work and organizing this. Thanks to all the volunteers. Thank you to our friend Johnny, who's been running around and organizing things. And thank you, of course, to all of our panelists for taking time out of their busy schedules. So I've got some introductory words, and then we're going to go to the panelists, and I'll describe the format in just a little bit. So like many of us, I am deeply concerned about the issue of gun violence in our country. Parkland was a wake-up call, but so was Orlando, and so was Las Vegas, and so was Fort Lauderdale, and so was Santa Fe, Texas, and so was Columbine, and so on. This country has a problem with gun violence that is unique in the developed world. More than 30,000 people a year die from gun violence in the United States of America. To put that figure in perspective, note that there are about 6,000 residents of Hudson. So we're talking five times the entire population of this city each year. So think about that. In a recent trip to China, I met up with a professor there and had a very interesting conversation. So another friend of mine from New Paltz asked this woman, Jenny, who's a professor in China, he said, this thing in Texas, do you ever have anything like that in China? And she gave the quickest and most straightforward answer, which was no, because guns are illegal in China. That was all she said. I thought that was pretty provocative. As a behavioral scientist, I'm a big believer in what we call multifactorial causation. Most behaviors and actions have multiple causes, and we need to truly embrace this concept as we move forward to address America's gun violence problem. It is up to us as active members of our community to draw on the best scientific data that exists on this topic and to enact legislation that follows from science. We are not going to solve our nation's gun problem without relying on the science, of this we can be assured. Across the nation, kids regularly experience lockdown drills, and they don't like it, and they don't deserve it. Our kids don't belong under their desks. They don't belong in closets. Our kids don't deserve to be scared to go to school. This is not the America that we know and love. It is up to all of us right now to take control of this situation. This is not about opinions, and we need to all realize this fact. This is not a political issue. This is a human issue. Everyone in this nation is dealing with the same problem right now. And wherever you are politically, we all have the same shared interest in fixing this problem. We are all in this together. So with this said, thank you so much to our panelists for taking the time out of their busy schedules to be here. Thank you all for coming out today. When community leaders get together and engage with the public, we all win. So thank you all for coming out today. A couple quick comments regarding the structure. We have eight panelists. Each panelist is going to speak for 4 minutes, and Megan and Andrew in the front are going to be very fierce keeping people on time, so if the panelists can just take a look, they have signs for 30 seconds, 1 minute, 30 seconds, and then a stop sign in red, just to try to keep things in order. After the panelists speak, there's going to be two sets of questions. There are questions that were submitted ahead of time that I will be reading to people, and there are questions that are people are going to ask actually on the spot. So we'll have about an hour worth of that, and then we'll wrap things up. So that is the process, and with that said, let me introduce our first speaker. The reason we are here today is for the kids, and this kid is the star of the Hudson High School, Sadiq Ahmed.
For and against gun violence and gun control and gun laws. But one thing that both sides have to agree on, that guns are used to kill. I just want to make it clear that I'm not here to argue. I want to get a better understanding of what you think about gun control, school safety, and mental health. We go to school to get an education, to learn new skills, and to pave a way for our future. None of us plan on getting shot or saying our last goodbyes to our parents before going to school. Very often, we hear the term mentally ill used to describe the shooters. This discussion should not just be talked about at school, but in homes as well. The shooter may have mental illness, but we cannot deny the fact that their actions classify them as terrorists. Or that word, terrorists. We start hearing that word more frequently after 9/11. It only took one tragic day, an airport security fight, there were extra screenings, and more precautions. How is it that over 20 school shootings in 2018 alone, and there is still no action? We had a national walkout a couple months ago in solidarity with the victims of the Parkland shooting. A couple students and I spoke at that event. Here I am again, speaking with a similar message. When will we say enough is enough and actually move forward to change gun laws, make our schools safer, and put more funds into helping and treating the mentally ill? How many more school shootings will it take for us to realize that just talking about this issue isn't enough? More lives will be in danger tomorrow if we do not act today. We cannot go back and change the past, but we can write a better future. A safer future. Let's run it together. Thank you.
Our next speaker on my list in this particular order is certified safety professional Mike Needham, who's an expert on gun safety with extensive training in that area. Mr. Needham.
Thank you. And what I'm really going to speak to today is school and community safety. Probably a little bit more than gun violence specifically. When we look at community violence, it goes way back in community violence against schools. Actually, we always think about things like Columbine as being obviously a tragic event, but it's not the first by any means. Probably the greatest act of school violence that we ever saw was in Bath, Wisconsin, over a century ago. A board member who was frustrated with his peers took 500 pounds of a material called pyrrolidone from his barn as a blasting agent, blew up a school building and killed pretty much every kid in the town. So this is not a new idea for us, but I think the problem that we're seeing now, and I think Sheriff Bartlett will probably attend to this as well, is this idea of active shooters. And I think if we're going to fix this problem, we really need to look at the root cause of it. It's not the lack of hardness of school doors, the lack of SROs and or training teachers and things like that. When we go through the list of factors of active shooters, and we call them factors, not profiles, but they're young males, typically 18 to 40. They don't deal with failure or lack of success very well. They lack social bonds. And those are two that I'm very, very interested in. If you think about that lack of social bonds, I grew up in a rural school district in North Carolina, and our church was the center of our town. Everything happened through the church. And FFA and Boy Scout and organizations like that. There's a lot of bonds with the community, and I think we're losing those in many respects. I heard one of my employees cite a study in a recent presentation on threat assessment and risk intervention for schools. He was saying he saw a survey from 1975 where they asked Americans, if something really bad happened to you in your life, how many people would have your back? How would be there to help you? And he said that the answer was typically 4 to 5 people. He said, when you ask that question now, it's often 0 to 1. And we've isolated ourselves in some ways. And so I think in the short term, people like me spend a lot of time hardening schools, camera technology, emergency response procedures, training and drilling and things like that. But the long-term fix for this particular problem is the strengthening of our communities and ultimately looking at ourselves a little bit in the mirror as parents too, and our role and how we're involved in our children's lives. And I think that longer term, that will ultimately have the greatest impact. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Next, we've got the director of mental health for Columbia County, Michael Cole. He is a licensed clinical social worker, administrator in the public sector for more than two decades, and he oversees a broad array of programs related to mental health issues. Michael Cole.
Good evening. I'm not sure I've ever spoken for 4 minutes, but I'm going to try. I'm going to talk about what I know, which is mental health and substance use. My title is Director of Community Services for Columbia County. I work for the Community Services Board in our county and the Board of Supervisors, and I oversee the care of individuals impacted by mental illness, substance use disorder, and intellectual disabilities. I'll just give you a brief overview of what we have in terms of mental health and substance abuse services in our schools in Columbia County. Five of the six districts have licensed OMH, Office of Mental Health Clinic satellites. Three districts have New York State Office of Alcoholism and Substance Abuse Service Prevention Services. The Department of Human Services and the Mobile Crisis Assessment Team have crisis support available for all districts. DARE, Catholic Charities, the Mentor Foundation, and school resource officers offer support across districts. The Department of Health has a health home care coordinator serving children in all of our districts. There are a variety of after-schools, esteem building, and pro-social activities which support our kids. There are many gaps and challenges setting up on-site services in schools. We must remember that mental health services and substance abuse services are voluntary. An individual engages in treatment not because they need it, but because they want it. To a large extent, there are some rare exceptions to that. It is my opinion that there is no single cause for why we're here tonight. Although it's very tempting for us to simplify this, and my opinion is that we have to look at multiple simultaneous solutions. A challenge that school districts have is that there is pressure, core curriculum and seat time pressures on faculty, and stigma restrict time available for on-site services. Districts often need services which are unreimbursable by clinic staff. Federal guidelines for prevention services restrict the type of services that are funded. Parental involvement in mental health and substance abuse treatment is essential, but yet very challenging because our parents, our families are very distressed and overwhelmed. Risk assessment and management is not a science. It's a blend of science and art. It's evolving science. We have opportunities. Districts could fund non-reimbursable services needed. Recent mental health education requirements will assist, I think, in increasing education and awareness of mental health and substance abuse issues. Just to speak briefly about the correlation between violence and mental illness. In stark contrast to media characterization, individuals impacted by the disease of mental illness are far more likely, 11 times more likely, to be the victims of violent crimes than they are perpetrators. Risk factors include adverse childhood experiences, exposure to physical, emotional, or sexual abuse or neglect, bullying, social isolation, food and housing insecurity, protective factors, include early intervention, opportunities to connect, opportunities to talk, pro-social opportunities. I could go on, but I'm getting a stop sign. Talk saves lives. Treatment works. Recovery is possible at all rounds.
Thank you.
So next on my list, I've got Columbia County Sheriff David Bartlett. He's been sheriff since 2013. He's got an extraordinary resume, including having won an award from the Insurance Women of the Hudson Valley for his part in disarming an armed suicidal individual, and a separate award from the New York State Sheriff's Association for pulling an individual from a burning vehicle. So I'm deeply impressed by this. Please join me in welcoming Sheriff Bartlett.
I'm just going to talk about what we've been doing here at the Sheriff's Office since I've become Sheriff, as far as active shooter situations and what we've been doing in the schools. Initially, when I came in, the only school that had a school resource officer was the school we're sitting in now. All the other schools, the governor pulled out the state police, and they were empty. Right away, I went right in, and think about training to kind of kills, went full-time in school resource deputies. Chatham, Levin, and Sherwin. Germantown and Hudson Sheriff. I'm happy to say I'm working with the Board of Supervisors right now on Channel Morale, and it looks very good that we're going to have full-time deputies now in all of the schools in the city, in the county. Germantown, Chatham, and Lebanon are all going on board. So I'm basically just working with them on funding. The school resource deputy program is more than just having a cop in the school. They're a resource for the school, they're working with the schools, they sit on panels, and they're a friend of the kids. They sit down and the kids actually trust them, and it's such a great partnership. Working with Mike, working with the other police agencies, the state police, the city of Hudson Police Department, we've got a great community, and I think Mike hit the nail right on the head. The community has to come together and has to work on this problem. Another thing that we've been doing, and we've been training, I can't even say hundreds of people, it's been thousands of people, in the Civilian Response to Active Shooter Event Program, or the CRACE program. And the CRACE program is basically a program that's going to give you situational awareness if you are at an active shooter event, or in some other type of an event where you need to help yourself and save yourself. What do we situations that are detailed in that case is the Warwick, Rhode Island fire many years ago, not that many years ago, where many people were killed in that fire. And people get their mindset of, if I ask everybody in the room right now, where's the exit? Probably the majority of people are going to say, close to me. Well, there's exits here, there's exits behind us. In the event of a fire, in the event of a situation in here. So the CRACE course is that we've had nothing but positive response back from that. And if you ever get a chance to take it, please, if you want it in your organization or in your work, please get a hold of me, and I'd be more than glad to set our people down to teach it. Deputies on the streets have been outfitted with the proper gear and equipment to deal with any type of situation in the schools. We train all together. All the agencies train, so it's not the state police are doing one thing, the sheriff's doing one thing, the city police are doing one thing. We train as a unit. We train as a community. So I want to thank everybody for coming here tonight. If you have any questions once we're done, because this is going to be a quick forum, please grab a hold of me or you can call me in my office. So thank you very much.
Next, we've got our congressman representing us from Kinderhook, John Faso. John has served as the minority leader of the New York State Assembly for several years, and he has served, he's been in public service since 1986, representing the people in New York. Relevant to today's topic, he's also a co-sponsor of House Bill 38, the Concealed Carry Reciprocity Act, which I know a few people have asked me to ask him about, to speak to, if that's feasible. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Faso.
Hey Ben, thank you very much, and thank you all of the folks in the audience for coming out tonight. This is a really important topic. Thank you, Maria, for opening the Hudson City Schools to us, and thank you, Billy Hughes, for organizing this. It's truly important. Let me address a number of issues, because the incidents that have occurred, whether it was Parkland recently, or Santa Fe, or Las Vegas, back to Columbine, and incidents that were mentioned well over 100 years ago. These all should all shock our conscience, and they should all spur us to try to address what are the causes of this, and what can we do collectively as communities, as government, as individuals, and as nonprofits and others to try to address this situation. So there have been a number of issues that have been raised, and a lot of those issues get raised here in questions tonight. Let me say a couple of things. In terms of a response that Congress has taken to the Las Vegas shooting, for instance, that individual used a device called a bump stop, which frankly most even gun enthusiasts never heard of this before. I had certainly never heard of it. That has effectively been outlawed now by the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. In response to that incident, where someone was able to convert a semi-automatic to a fully automatic weapon. Automatic weapons have been illegal in this country or highly regulated in this country since the 1930s. And oftentimes, devices like the bump stock come to the scene which frankly turn a weapon which is legal into one that is illegal. That has now been banned. But the second thing that I think is important is that there were loopholes in the background check system, and we saw this vividly in connection with the Texas church shooting last year, where a dishonorably discharged Air Force veteran who was dishonorably discharged for domestic violence, his dishonorable discharge was never reported to the background check system. That has now been changed in law, enacted into law, signed by the president, so that the government agencies, particularly the military in this situation, must refer such individuals to the background check. We have also greatly enhanced funding that flows through the states to the various community and local organizations for mental health funding. But this is an enormous gap that we have in our services. And it's very true that mental health is not necessarily correlated to these shooters, who are overwhelmingly aged 15 to 25 or 30, who are male, who are young men and boys who have, whether they've been bullied in school, whether they've been isolated, whether they feel a social estrangement from their families and their community. That is, I think, probably the focus that we need to pay most attention to, which is why are these young people, these boys and young men, so taken to and so alienated that they would commit these type of crimes. Lastly, Congress has also, besides enacting legislation on a bipartisan basis that I voted for in the budget last March, greatly increasing mental health funding, we've also increased funding for school security. It is nowhere near enough. It was about $75 million, but it was a start. And this will assist schools to harden their facilities, to make themselves more safety conscious, etc. Lastly, I want to say that we're also working on legislation that would be a red flag law, protecting due process rights for individuals. But if a school or family member feels that an individual is a threat to themselves or their communities, a red flag law modeled after something already in place in Indiana for the last 10 years, and it's worked successfully, would allow, with due process rights, would allow a judge to remove firearms from an individual who is deemed a threat to themselves or their community. So there are many other pieces of legislation we can discuss, and I'm glad to be here tonight to have the opportunity to answer your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Congressman Faso. Next, we've got someone who I think has played a big role in helping today happen, the superintendent for our district that we're in here in Hudson, Dr. Maria Suttmeier, a recent winner of the Sons and Daughters of Italy Positive Image Award for positive work in the community. Thank you for hosting us, and please join me in welcoming Dr. Maria
Suttmeier. Thank you. First, I just want to personally thank everyone for coming out this evening and welcome you to our school district. When Bill Hughes came to me and said, are you interested in hosting a conversation about school safety and gun issues and mental health issues, of course, how could I say no? It is home for us. I feel highly responsible, not only for the academic outcomes of our students here in school, but you can't have academic progress in our school without being safe. Our students need to be able to come to school and have fun, feel safe, and learn without worrying about what might happen with violence in schools. When I started my career here in Hudson 19 years ago, it was the week of Columbine. So it is unbelievable that we are still talking about school violence and students being killed in school settings almost 20 years later. So it's time that we put our heads together, talk with our experts, come together as a community, and figure out what the solutions are. We know that students need assistance. We know that they need an education that is free from violence. How do we do that? As a school district, you know, every time something hits the news, you tighten up. You think of one more thing that you might be able to do to keep your school secure, keep your children safe. I have just under 1,800 students congregating Monday through Friday. They're walking through our doors at 8 o'clock in the morning. That's a heavy responsibility and a burden when you feel that you need to do everything you can to protect them so that they come to school for all of the right reasons. So that's why we're here tonight, is how can we work together to ensure that that is what's happening in our schools across the country. We're doing what we can to provide safety protocols. I'm working collaboratively with our community-based organizations, our law enforcement. We have Mike Needham that works closely with our school district every year to provide us with expert experience and advice of how we can do things better in our schools. But yet, when I'm listening to the news and yet another event is happening, you wonder, are you doing enough? And it has to happen outside of our schools. The schools cannot do this alone. We need to come together as a country and we need to start changing how we're doing things. So I'm delighted to have everyone here tonight. I think having conversations like this are going to be the difference and the game changer for us. So thank you for being here tonight, and let's hope we come away with a goal of improving our safety in our schools.
Thank you, Dr. Suttmeier. And next we've got another representative. We've got Assemblymember Dee Barrett, who represents folks here in the 106th Legislative District of New York. She's been doing this since 2012. She has worked extensively on issues related to women's issues, agriculture, mental health, among many others. Please join me in welcoming Assemblymember Dee Barrett.
And I want to also thank Bill Hughes and Maria for organizing this. I can't think of a better place for a conversation like this than in our schools and in our school here in Columbia County, because whether you're a gun owner and a second right advocate or whether you're a gun control advocate, you care about your children, you care about our community, and this is where we should be having these conversations. So thank all of you for being here and being part of this conversation, as well as my colleagues on the panel here. So my first instinct when it comes to gun violence is always as a mother. Following each of these instincts, I imagine what it would be like to be the mother of a victim. I also imagine what it would be like to be the mother of a shooter. As a mother, in the end, I will do whatever I can to prevent another parent from burying a child from gun violence. And that means whether the shooting happens in school on a campus, whether it happens on their way to and from school, and these are not just young men who are shooting kids in those situations. It matters whether it's in their neighborhoods, it matters when it's in their home. And it's the vote that I took when I supported the SAFE Act. It was an imperfect legislation the way it came about, but again, my commitment is to do anything that I can to keep another parent from having to bury a child in that. Let me also say that it isn't my goal to restrict access to responsible, law-abiding gun owners either. I support the Second Amendment, and I recognize the importance that sports and shooting sports and hunting are to our region and are to many families in our region, and I support the right for those families to have those, to be law-abiding and to practice safe gun practices in their communities. However, every year the CDC and the FBI report that more than 30,000 American lives are cut short from gun violence, and more than half of those are suicides, which is a really important piece of this gun violence issue. Every day, 19 children are shot in America, according to a recent study, and nearly 1,300 kids under the age of 18 die every year from gunshot wounds, and that's according to the CDC. I've spoken to parents, teachers, school administrators across my district that talk about mental health being the number one issue in their classrooms. This includes elementary school. So the stress that our kids are operating under every single day is really untenable. And that includes having to do drills that make them go into a closet at this point when they're doing safe shooter training drills. And it's kind of impossible to imagine sending your child to school to have them do that kind of drill at the, you know, at the age of 5 or 6 or 7 or even older. Recently I went to Taconic Hills when they had the National Walkout Day, and we talked, as we have, as I said earlier, about how this is really a place where our schools could be having this conversation. I know that there continues to be a disconnect between what Americans want. 97% of people surveyed in the National Quinnipiac poll support background checks. We've seen that over and over again, yet almost a quarter of gun purchases are obtained without any kind of background check. So this disconnect is something that we have to work on. We have to have the conversations, have the dialogues that make us move forward on the kind of legislation and the kind of policies that will change this trajectory in our country. I thank you all for being part of that.
Thank you, Dean. And last but not least, we have got the police chief of the great city of Hudson, Edward Moore. He has served as a New York State trooper for 32 years, and he has served as the chief of police here since 2013. Please join me in welcoming Chief Moore.
Thank you very much. I'm very honored to be on this panel tonight. Before I say a few words, this time of year, I'm always a little nostalgic. I think about 40 years ago, getting ready for my prom, like the kids here at Hudson are tonight, tomorrow, and worrying about getting a few dollars for my car, for gasoline, or worrying about my tuxedo. But it's stunning in contrast with what these kids have to worry about today. It's rather sad. I never once, back in the 70s, had to concern myself with thinking about being a victim of a gun violence in my school. So it's kind of sad, and something we need to get in the right direction. You know, my duties here as your police chief is that, in all likelihood, one of my officers will be the first person on the scene. I've been at a scene of a active shooter that there was no training involved, there was no preparation, and it was an unorganized mess that was very dangerous. My mission is to make sure that that does not happen here. I'm very comfortable with the relationship we have with the Sheriff's Office, State Police, School District. My sole job is to be prepared, train, prepare, and to practice, to put everything, every asset we can to protect the children of this school district. And I pledge to you that is what we will do. We've made great progress, very comfortable with the relationship we have with law enforcement. But I see that as my duty to make sure that we're here. I see it Bartlett, I saw it at Columbine, the mistakes that were made. People weren't prepared, the officers did not do the right thing. I have to make sure the responsibility is on my shoulders, that that doesn't happen here. And that is what I pledge to you. Thank you.
The next section of the agenda is essentially going to be reading for the panelists questions that have been submitted ahead of time. And while I do have some names of some specific panelists here, if anyone wants to jump in or has thoughts, please, by all means, we welcome that. So here's a question from Elmer LeSueur. and it is this. Is there any local, state, federal, or other grants or funding resources available to do a safety assessment so that we can figure out which schools are at higher risk, what programs, funds, or resources are available to make any needed improvements that don't require putting guns in teachers' hands? And the first person listed here, so maybe I'll list the two people and then others who want to jump in. The first person listed here is Dee Dee. So Dee Dee, if you could respond to that.
I mean, I think that it would be better to hear from Mike Needham about this, because if we're actually looking at these policies, there is potentially state funding, but this is not the kind of policies that New York State would necessarily put forward, so.
Sure.
There's a number of pieces of legislation and regulations, specifically the commissioner's regulations related to school safety that kind of fall into play here. One of them that's important and we haven't really spoken about here is Dignity for All Students Act, which is another of the factors when we think about violence. If we have to do training each year, there's a process where if a student's bullied or harassed, we can report that, and that's kind of important. And then we also have the Schools Against Violence and Education rules. We have building level emergency response plans, and we do training, and we do assessments of the facilities. And it's sort of a complicated question. We look at the plant facilities of the school, we look at door hardening, we look at Hudson has a fairly special door technology, they're called intruder locks that many schools don't have, these types of things. So we think about physical security within the school building. And then we also think about the other components, the risk assessments in terms of the population. And that's something that actually Hudson's doing a lot of work on, because generally if somebody's going to hurt other people, they usually give you clues that law enforcement refers to as leakage. They tell you voluntarily or involuntarily through their Facebook posts and the poetry they write, the pictures they draw, that they may be contemplating hurting somebody. And that's where the money is really in many ways for schools, is doing a really, really good job of identifying students and getting intervention. You've heard our experts say it works. And that's a message that I've heard over and over and over. In terms of specific funding to look at one school versus another, I think that's complex. For example, when you think about active shooters, the data appears to show that they're more likely to impact rural and suburban than urban schools. But I think a lot of them are ultimately personal factors. And schools in general are working really hard on their plant facilities, their training, and these what we call threat assessment or risk intervention strategies. And there's a number of resources for schools, law enforcement, New York State Police, Safe Schools New York, people like me, the Board of Cooperative Educational Services has programs and health schools as well. So there's all kinds of resources available to schools now to lead to things. In terms of a specific stream of funding, I can't think of something specifically that relates to threat assessment in schools, but it happens already in many, many different ways.
Thank you, Mike. If I could just give a quick follow-up, part of the question there has to do with the idea of instead of kind of doing these things, instead of having guns in teachers' hands. So what are your thoughts about that issue?
I think that, instead of having guns in teachers' hands, I agree with that. I don't think that teachers should be armed. And I say that in a I'm speaking from a practical perspective. My background is military security. And one of the things that I know, and I would defer to our friends in law enforcement, though, ultimately, is that it takes a lot of training to handle a firearm and to use it correctly and use it safely. That's not something we can do once a year. So there's a very practical component just if we wanted somebody to maintain their skills with a firearm. I think the other problem is the safety factor. When the Hudson police, when the sheriffs, New York State police, we've had schools where the FBI showed up in incidents that we've had. They don't even necessarily know each other. And if somebody steps out in the hallway with a weapon, it may be difficult for police officers to distinguish that person from some of these hospitals. So I think there's other reasons that Dr. Suttmeier might have as to why teachers ultimately shouldn't be armed. But mine is practical. It's about safety and competency would be a concern. But I think the things that we can do as schools today, because I think that the real solutions are long-term and they're very complex, but the things we do today, we practice, we identify risk, we try to mitigate that risk as early on as we can, and I think there's good systems in this school district for doing that. We practice response actions so that we know what to do if something happens. We work very closely with the police. The school conducts at least 8 drills a year, and that's not necessarily a good thing. I think we've heard a lot of people say it, but maybe it's a necessary thing while we're working towards the bigger solutions that we that are available to us.
Great, thank you, Mike. And so to respond to your comment, if we could have Dr. Suttmeier speak to this issue as well, that would be great.
I agree that teachers should not be armed in schools. First of all, that's not their profession. That's not what they are certified to do. They are certified to teach, to work with curriculum, and make sure that they're using best practices so that they're delivering that curriculum with instruction that's meaningful for our students. It's not what they're paid to do. Teachers are doing much more than giving the students the knowledge and the skills that they need to be successful in any content area or grade level. We're building relationships with students. We're making sure that they have someone that they feel safe that they can talk to, counseling them, being their friend, sometimes being a parent, if that's what they need on any particular day or year. We've strengthened our relationships and make sure that we can reach them to teach them. The one title that a teacher does not have is an officer. They're not an armed guard, and that's not how we should be conducting our educational experiences for our students. And I feel very strongly about that.
Yeah, you're right. Excuse me. Sure.
As Mike said, and Dr. Suttmeier, the teachers should not be armed. They should not be running around with guns. I'm a New York State firearms instructor. I have been for many years. And sending that round down range is a big responsibility. And you really have to have the training and the education. And as Mike said, it's not something that you get once a year. We need to lead that to the professionals. With that being said, this costs money. And this is where I'm hoping that our state representatives that are here today can look at that and see if any funding can be found for school resource deputies to help the schools. Currently, right now, what we do is we split it 50-50. Schools pay half, the county pays half. But it's tough. Budgets are tight. There's restrictions, there's caps, there's so on and so forth that we have to deal with. And I would hope that we can take this back to Albany where they can look and they can say, let's fund some money for the school resource officers, get the cops in the schools, work with the schools, and have the professionals do the job that we're supposed to do, and that's protecting you. Thank you.
Thank you. That the Smart Schools Bond Act has been specifically reshaped so that money can be used specifically for this. So if Dr. Suttmeier or anyone wants to reach out, we're happy to work with you on making sure that Hudson gets that money.
Elmer's question has also requested a response from Congressman Faso, and perhaps you could speak to the issue of national legislation that might be able to help with these issues.
Well, I too, let me just say, I think that from the experts that I've spoken to, the training and the response time and the adrenaline rush that occurs when you're in an active shooter situation, when that officer draws their weapon, it is something that would be very difficult to have someone who is only an incidental gun owner deal in that situation. So I'm in agreement with what the sheriff and Dr. Suttmeier said in terms of whether arming teachers is advisable. What we have done at the congressional levels, we've made money available. Again, it's a $75 million in the last appropriation bill nationwide. Is a drop in the bucket, frankly, for what the need is across the nation. But part of those funds could be used for those type of assessments. And I think, though, that from my experience in talking to school superintendents and principals and school board members in the 11 counties that comprise our congressional district, I can tell you that these discussions are already ongoing. And what Mike Needham had indicated is absolutely true. And I think we should all take some reassurance to the fact that communities are having these kind of meetings among their constituencies. And that's really appropriate and very much needed. So I appreciate what Mike is doing and what other professionals are doing to try to help school officials assess the needs that they have in their districts.
Thank you. So our second question comes from Claire Copley, who asks a question regarding the history of arms in our country. And the question is this: the founders of our country could not foresee technological advances when they crafted the Constitution or the Bill of Rights. Can you please discuss the actual practical differences between regulating the ownership and operation of automobiles and regulating firearms? So I guess there's a couple different issues in there. I guess A, speaking to whether the Second Amendment might be a bit antiquated, I'm interpreting the first part, and secondly, what do you think about regulating firearms the same way that we do automobiles? And this is one for all the panelists, so whoever wants to speak first.
Well, I think I'll go first on that. I think the founders could not have contemplated some of the weaponry that exists today, certainly. They couldn't have contemplated jet plane travel, and they couldn't have contemplated the internet. And yet we still are able to manage to deal within the constraints of Commerce Clause and free speech and accommodate these innovations that have occurred over the centuries. I don't think the Second Amendment is outmoded. I fully support the Second Amendment, and I think what's instructive, I think, is for folks to read the majority and the dissenting opinions in the Heller case, Justice Scalia's majority opinion, and the dissenting opinion. I can't recall right now which judge wrote the dissent, but they're both very well crafted. And the Heller case is interesting, and it's interesting in the context of today, because in that instance, the District of Columbia had sought to, in essence, bar a citizen from having a engaged active firearm in their home. In other words, you had to basically disable the firearm in their home in order to comply with the DC statute. Mr. Heller was a security guard, a licensed armed security guard at a federal office building in Washington, DC, and he objected to this since he was licensed. What the District of Columbia wanted to do was basically take away his Second Amendment rights. And Justice Scalia traced the history of the Second Amendment back to the 1650s in England. And the bottom line is that the Second Amendment, as Justice Scalia said, is not open-ended. It is not a blank check. There can be limits that the government can rationally place on firearm ownership and use. And indeed, the government has done that from time to time. I mentioned the high regulation that automatic weapons came about after the 1920s and 30s, the gangland, the Al Capone situations. So machine guns, as we commonly know them, are outlawed. When you hear people talk about the use of automatic weapons today, well, they're actually incorrect, because semi-automatics are legal. Automatic weapons are very highly regulated and indeed illegal in most contexts. So I do think that we have to be rational about this discussion. I mean, the SAFE Act is something that many people objected to in New York State, and the SAFE Act, in essence, enacted certain bans on certain semi-automatic weapons. And if you go and Google SAFE Act compliant semi-automatics, you will find a whole host of weapons that are legal in New York State, that have all of the firing capacity of a semi-automatic that is now illegal under New York law. But this semi-automatic Safe Act compliant weapon is commonly available. In fact, the shooter that went into a Bronx hospital a year ago or 2 years ago had a Safe Act compliant semi-automatic weapon. So I think what the important thing here is for us to recognize that that shooter in Florida, in Parkland, that young man should never have been able to buy a BB gun, much less a semi-automatic or any other kind of firearm. Numerous people dropped the ball, whether it was the FBI, which had two explicit warnings about this individual, whether it was the local law enforcement, which had gone to this young man's home about 30 times, whether it was the school, which had expelled this individual for violence against a teacher, and they refused to prosecute him because they didn't want to give him a record. Well, now we see what the consequences of that were. So there are many, many issues that arise with the modern day usage of the Second Amendment as the modern day usage of the Commerce Clause and the Free Speech Amendment, etc. We can accommodate our needs for safety and security, maintain a safe, a Second Amendment and our constitutional rights, and do this in a logical, coherent way so that we're protected. But the rights of law-abiding people, who overwhelmingly are not the people that commit crimes with firearms, are protected.
Thank you, Congressman. Other panelists who'd like to speak to this, and again, it's a two-pronged question, A, dealing with the whether the Second Amendment is still an appropriate policy for our nation, and B, whether guns should be regulated the same way that automobiles are regulated. Any other panelists want to speak to that? Okay, moving forward. Next question. Very similar question. We'll go to the next one. This comes from Fran Miller, directly for Congressman Faso. Congressman Faso, given that you have been the recipient of funding from the NRA, how is it that you can say you're supporting the current drive to end gun violence? Will you promise tonight to refuse to take campaign donations from the NRA?
Society that we live in, I think that goes to the key of what we've got to address. And I also think this is an area where people on both sides of the firearms debate, good people of good faith, could find common ground to solve this problem. And so that's why I earnestly ask people on both sides of this issue to work together to solve this problem.
I guess there's a specific request of yes or no to that element of the question.
The answer is no.
Moving on, we've got a question from our friend Leo Wilcox. It's a detailed question, and this goes to several panelists. My husband is a gun owner and veteran. We live on a small farm in Columbia County. We think there are common sense solutions that will stop people with dangerous histories from buying guns. As long as we allow gun sales to happen without a background check, it will remain far too easy to buy a gun. With a recent poll showing 97% of gun owners support H.R. 4240, the Public Safety and Second Amendment Rights Protection Act, a bill that requires criminal background checks on all commercial gun sales, and has 208 co-sponsors, including two Republicans from New York, will you join them and co-sponsor that particular bill? So it's an issue that's kind of impact.
Familiar with the legislation, I'll take a look at it, but the point, the vast majority of firearm sales done with commercial dealers all have to be subject to a background check. New York State already has even more extensive rules than what the federal government has. The difference in terms of background checks is whether or not a transfer between a family member, one to another, should be subject to a background check. And I think there you'll find most people, the polls are much closer on that topic, not the 98% or 97% that you mentioned.
Good, thank you. Others named here are Dr. Suttmeier and David Bartlett, if you'd like to speak to this issue.
Background checks is good. We run all the background checks on all the pistol permits. We vet everybody. If there's any issues, it's forward to the county judges, and the judges decide whether or not they're going to need a permit. The mental health checks are good. You know, people just don't go out and buy guns and get handy guns and go do what you got to do with it. So, I mean, I absolutely agree that background checks are good. And it's being done already, like the congressman said. This one bought a pistol the other day. First thing they did was just go through the FBI. And then I'm sure, I looked through all the paperwork and had me checked.
What about
guns? Dr. Sutton.
Yes, I agree with the limitations. A background check makes sense. For reasonable people, we need to start practicing some reasonable procedures in allowing people to buy a firearm. It's responsible use, but I would also say that it's access to guns too. Some of the people that are creating this mayhem and violence are not the ones that purchase the guns, but they have access to the guns. So we have to make sure that they're secure.